Hello, everyone. Welcome to Day 2 of Restaurants Rise, Part 2, Week 2. I'm Alan Little, Senior Editor of Data and Event Content for Nation's Restaurant News. These are challenging times for all. So today and tomorrow, we continue on with our series of programs and presentations to provide you with information, inspiration, and solutions. Register for our remaining sessions and access on-demand views of our previous programs at the www.restaurantsrise.com website. I'm pleased to be supporting this session on Never Have I Ever, a Q&A on transforming guest experience post-COVID-19, presented by Wisely. Find out more about Wisely at restaurantsrise.com and see some of the great resources they've put in place for you on our Resource Center page at that website. We will be taking questions at the end of this presentation. Please use the Q&A window in your webinar console to submit your question, and we'll get to as many as possible. To customize your viewing experience, you can move or resize the windows in your console. If you experience any technical issues, simply refresh your console by pressing the F5 keys on a Windows system and Command and R keys if you're on a Mac. Now I'd like to introduce our speakers. Mike Vichich, the Chief Executive and Co-Founder of Wisely. Scott Lawton, Chief Executive and Co-Founder of bartaco. And Matt Eisenacher, that would be Matt Eisenacher, Senior Vice President of Brand Strategy and Innovation at First Watch Restaurant. Mike, would you please get us started?
Absolutely. Thank you, Alan. And thanks, Matt and Scott, for joining too. My name is Mike Vichich. I'm one of the co-founders of Wisely. And thanks to everybody out there for tuning in. We know how challenging the last 5 or so months have been. I can't even believe it's been that long already. Navigating the COVID crisis. And as many of you may have already heard, the Chinese word for crisis is wei ji, which is wei means danger, ji means opportunity. And so despite all the danger and challenges that everybody's faced, there is a reinvention happening as well, where people have been freed up to try new stuff. And I think that's true on the brand side, and it's also true on the guest side. And I'm really excited to hear from Scott and Matt and let them share their experience. I think they and their teams have done an incredible job moving mountains for their guests to make sure that everyone is safe and still having a good time, even though the world's a little different. So our hope is that you come away from today's conversation with one or two specific concrete things that you can go do and that helps you fight back during this time. Brief bit about myself. I grew up as a server in restaurants, where I learned firsthand the value and the importance of a great guest experience. After college, I was at Accenture for 5 years, where I was a data nerd, helping big brands understand who their customers were, what their customer profitability was, what their customer lifetime value was, all that. And we at Wisely believe that good decision making really is founded on a deep understanding of your customers. So our mission is to help brands better engage with their guests and drive profit at scale. And, you know, think of it as like, we want to be able to bring a Starbucks-like digital experience to brands of all sizes, whether you're 3 units or 3,000. And with that, I will pass it over to Scott and let him introduce himself and bartaco.
Hi, I'm Scott Lawton. I'm the CEO and co-founder of bartaco Restaurants. We have 20 restaurants, mainly on the East Coast, but some in Colorado, Nashville, Wisconsin, and dotted around, and we're continuing to grow.
Matt?
Afternoon, everybody. Matt Eisenacher, I'm the Senior Vice President of Brand Strategy and Innovation here at First Watch Restaurants. We're based in Sarasota, Florida, and I'd actually be curious if we took a poll to see if anyone would guess how many restaurants we have. Typically, people would guess 30, 50, 70, and don't realize we have 400 restaurants across 31 states. So, you know, we pride ourselves on being the leaders in breakfast, brunch, and lunch, and really excited to be here today and talk about the last few months.
Awesome. So to get things kicked off, we're going to do lightning round Q&A, just to give everyone context on what's been happening with both bartaco and First Watch. So first question, I'll do each of them. Scott, Matt, you guys just let me know what the situation is. So your off-prem sales as a percentage of total pre-COVID, post-COVID. Scott.
Okay, pre-COVID, we did takeout, no delivery, and it was about 7% of our sales. We've settled in right now where it's about 29% of our sales, with a combination of still being about 7%, well, actually being 7% delivery and 22% takeout.
Matt? Yeah, actually, it's not all too different here. I preface this just to lay it out for everyone. So we actually are a pretty unique circumstance. In January of this year, if you wanted to place a takeout order in our restaurants, you actually had to pick up the phone. Pretty ludicrous, right? I mean, it's you talk about a brand that was really caught when this all happened. We had started down that path, but so we had a little bit of takeout from the phone, call it 5%, and at that time, really there was very little delivery. So 5% before COVID and off premise, and we're settling in right about 30% as well. So really similar to Bartaco.
Awesome. So substantial growth in off-prem. Be curious to hear third party as a percentage of your off-prem pre-post. Scott.
Yeah, I'll go first.
Oh,
so the third party delivery was something we had only piloted in say 50 restaurants here in Florida. We saw about 4% of sales with one delivery partner in those restaurants, just in a pilot. Fast forward, latest week, I think we're right around the 12-13% range across two providers, with the balance of that up to the 30% going to direct orders through our app or through online ordering through the web.
So yeah, we're doing about 4-7% in delivery, but we have not been utilizing third-party sites as we haven't wanted to pay the fees that they charge. So we've been utilizing Olo through Rails and their technology, utilizing the third parties, but through our website so that we wouldn't have to pay the fees. So we are looking into possibly expanding that as we see there is a lot of demand for it, but we haven't really pushed it that hard yet.
Cool, and last question on the lightning round, comp sales. Scott, go for it.
Yeah, right now we're at about 70%, pushing 70% as of last week of last year's sales prior week. We've been holding steady at about that for about 5 weeks, 6 weeks, roughly. We have some stores that are as high as 80-90% of sales and some that are as low as 40-50%. But across the brand, we're at about 70%.
Yeah, so comp sales, say January and February, we were hovering around, call it 5%, doing pretty well. And then, I think most people probably saw we did make the decision to close all of our corporate restaurants completely for about 6 weeks, which really led to a lot of the technology changes that we put in place during that time. Coming back out of it, you read a lot of articles about breakfast and you really think it's fallen off a cliff, and we haven't seen that. We're actually only off in the latest week, only 15% off of last year, which is really, really incredible. I think in the breakfast day part, it's really a tale of two cities. You got QSR, which is a totally different beast. But we've really been pleased, even with weekday sales. It just goes to show people still want an experience. So we've been pleased.
Great. So for the rest of the conversation, we're going to center it kind of 10 minutes on each of these three topics, covering kind of high-level business issues. Then we're going to chat about the guests, and then we'll talk last about some operations and marketing changes that you all have made. First, focusing on the business questions, Scott, I know that Bartaco has always been about guest experience. That's, as long as I've known you, which has been a few years now. That's something you guys talk about all the time. Today you say safety is hospitality. And so I'd love to hear from you. What is different now about the Bartaco guest experience and what's the same?
Yeah, I mean, I want to preface it with, when COVID first hit, a lot of our density is in Connecticut and in Westchester and in that area. And we got hit really hard. And we saw the effects of COVID firsthand. It really frightened us. And that's where we really started that phrase, safety's hospitality. Because if we're going to connect with our customers, we have to do it in a safe way. And if we're going to empower our staff to come to work, we have to make sure they feel safe when they come in. So So what we've been striving for is creating a model where we can still provide the vibe that bartaco provides with the music and the great food and the lively staff, but do it safely. And we didn't really feel comfortable as we started to open up capacity and put seats in the restaurant to go back to full service the way we had done it before, putting servers in front of customers with no masks throughout the day. You could just see the fear in their eyes when we were asking them to do it. So you know, we really had to figure out ways to do this safely. And we went to our partners digitally, like you, like Wisely and with Olo, and really worked hard to figure out how do we manage these crowds before they ever get in the door. You know, we used to have bustling bars that we would pack and have a wait list, and that's just not something we could do now. So how do we manage those people? We still have the demand. The customers want to come in. So, you know, how do we control that before they ever get in the door? How do we have a virtual host stand and make sure that they know when it's safe to walk in and we'll have a table ready for them? How can they order without having a waiter standing there, walking them through the order through the whole process and having to touch the table multiple times? So, you know, we really worked hard on getting the digital solutions in place with a lot of support from our partners. And we've pushed that model very hard. We still are basically going serverless. We have servers working in the restaurants, but they're part of a team that is really just making sure that service flows. All of the ordering is happening digitally at the tables through QR codes. And, you know, we are still trying to make sure that the vibe is right and that people can have an experience, but we are keeping it safe.
Yeah, absolutely. And Matt, similar story from your perspective. You've talked a lot about First Watch being an occasion. So can you know how you've transitioned that from, you know, the on-prem experience and thinking about what it looks like off-prem?
Yeah, it's a big shift for us. You know, like I said, we're a unique concept. We're built and have been built for a four walls experience. And, you know, we really didn't build that digital experience, frankly, because we didn't need to. But, you know, it's something that we had been working on for quite a while. You know, I think the one thing I would say about this, though, about the dine-in experience and transitioning that to an off-prem occasion is, you know, I think everyone needs to realize those are really two different occasions. And right now, when you look at the industry, you see a lot of places that are really actively shifting everyone actively to the takeout experience. Well, I mean, I'll speak for us, and I know it's a its own circumstance, but you know, 70% of our sales right now are coming from our dining rooms. You know, we have really built an occasion around brunch. We believe that we're the leaders in brunch, and brunch is, you know, a social occasion. It's connection with family. It's connection with friends. And if you think about it, now more than ever, people still want to do that. Now, they're being more judicious on where the places are that they choose to do that. But the reason I bring that up is because, you know, for us, it's been really important to realize those are two different need states. So, you know, we want to make sure that we're building convenience for convenience, but we don't want to sacrifice that warmth and that experience of our dining rooms. I mean, when you talk about one of the key things that we wanted to keep front and center about our experience going to takeout, you know, packaging was a key one. If you've been to a First Watch restaurant, you'll realize presentation of the food is extremely important to us. You know, you eat with your eyes first. So for us, you know, we made a very large investment in packaging and making sure that when you take your food out of the bag, you have that same experience, that same wow, where you're able to see your food. You know, along the same lines, I would say, you know, we obviously put a really big investment into technology, both in off-premise online ordering, but then in CRM and marketing automation. And, you know, the reason we do that is because, again, thinking of those two occasions as being different. You know, if you're someone who comes into our dining room every week and you're a high frequency customer, I don't necessarily want to push online ordering down your throat. I don't need to. And you've already really shown that you're in this for a different reason, right? So understanding and getting customer data and understanding what and how they use us allows us to customize the communication. So if you're dining in our dining room regularly, I might want to share with you information about our shareables platform and Million Dollar Bacon or Holy Donuts or alcohol, right? Let's help you make that experience even more of an experience. Whereas if you were someone in our dining rooms and is now moving to off-premise, I might tell you about our app, right? And you can actually order from us and experience us in a more convenient manner. So we doubled down on digital technologies when we closed our restaurants so that we knew that over the next 9 to 12 months, we have the ability to customize communication.
And so that's a really key point, Matt. I think, you know, in talking with you over the months and years, I think you've done a very good job and your team has done a very good job of having a tech roadmap and kind of defining where you want to be in the future. And so when COVID hit, you were able to accelerate that, but it required you to have done all that. You couldn't have moved that fast had you not done that thinking before. So could you just share for the group, you know, how did you decide what you were solving for with technology? Because it doesn't solve everything, right? What were you solving for, and how did you prioritize those projects?
Yeah, it's a good question because, you know, we've done a lot of interviews because, you know, we literally had to turn full off-premise and digital infrastructure in the matter of days. It just didn't exist. So you're right. Part of that was because we had a very solid roadmap that was already aligned. And, you know, in the industry, we think of roadmaps for tech companies, but, you know, for any restaurant company of a larger size, off-premise, it doesn't just affect brand, it runs havoc on your accounting department. And obviously your operators is a whole new muscle for them. And so, you know, prior, as we were going into 2020, you know, we had already as an organization throughout 2019 established the steps of the roadmap of what we wanted to get to. And so by the time it hit in March, it was really a matter of just brute force in accelerating those steps. So for us, you know, starting from square one, it was first about accessibility. So, you know, obviously we partnered with Olo and we wanted to let you order in any way that you wanted to experience First Watch. So that was the first thing. We were moving on that already. The second thing was customer information on our customers. You know, previously, we couldn't have told you anything, not only demographics, but behaviors, cross-selling, items, days of the week. We didn't know anything. That was the second step. And then the third one was segmentation and customized communication. So, you know, Olo and then Wisely really filled in the gap on customer knowledge. And then now we're at the stage now where we're starting to customize our communication. So, you know, all of that happened with a compressed time frame, and it wasn't a question of aligning the board or aligning the different departments. We simply went and accelerated wait lists. We accelerated CRM, and we moved all those, you know, very quickly. And to give you a great example about then how they work together, you know, the great thing is when we accelerated waitlist, which is one of our largest customer technologies, you know, if you think about it, because it's integrated with our CRM program and we're capturing all of that information, you know, here in the home office where we manage the CRM database, if we find that a certain frequency set is considered, say, our top 10%, right, and they're our VIPs, we can designate that in the database. It flows right down into the wait list. And so when you, Mike, who's a high frequency customer, come in and check in at our wait stand or our host stand, it immediately would have a designation next to your name. And so our host and our servers immediately know who you are, and it gives us a way to customize the experience. So it's just an example of all those technologies then can work with each other, and it allows us to create a really customized experience for every guest.
Yeah, especially as, you know, when you're rehiring teams, they may not know who your best customers are. So you're able to retain that knowledge across team members. That's nice. Scott, and then, you know, one of the things that you and I have talked about over the years is how IT isn't IT anymore, right? A lot of times you're hearing people call it technology, and Domino's is a tech company that sells pizza and things like that. And I've heard you talk about, you know, you want someone that obviously can handle and run all of the core systems like a point of sale and a GL and all that, but you also need someone who's a leader and a visionary, come up with the vision and then go execute on it. So how have you found that process to be finding that sort of a leader?
Yeah, you know, it's traditional IT is one thing, and then there's what we're doing, which is, you know, nowadays we're seeing there's so many best in class systems out there. And to me, the name of the game is integration. It's actually getting sort of the best things and putting them together. It's not buying a one-size-fits-all system that has each module and it's all integrated. The way we've sort of thought about it is it's better to find the best in class and then figure out how to make it all work together. Things integrate better now than they used to. Some of the POS systems are a little clunky, but you know, a lot of the ancillary systems are really able to integrate, like through Omnivore and things like that. So you know, we've hired a great IT director who we think is going to be a great thought partner with us, and we've had R3 Manny Lewis, who's a great thought partner as well, and we've been able to work together and sort of figure out how we can cobble all of these things together, because we really do want the best in class when we're talking about our CRM, when we're talking about our ordering, when we're, you know, each piece, when we're looking at our labor software, all of these things need to work best for our customers and for our staff. And right. We would rather spend all the time in the background figuring out how to make it work together and have what's best for our customers and what's best for our staff.
Yep. Absolutely. Yeah, and the API point, I think, is more critical than ever. Matt, obviously, you've got experience with that as well. Transitioning now to focus on guests for a little while. You know, Scott, when one of the things you've said is that guests are more open-minded today and they're more forgiving. They're open to trying new things. So talk to us about how you've used the COVID situation as an opportunity to experiment with what dine-in looks like in the future, and talk to us a little bit about that.
Yeah, you know, the guest is just excited to get out, and you know, especially when we first came out of quarantine, you know, people were just excited to be sitting at a table and being fed food. So, you know, that really opened up a lot of opportunities for us to try some things. QR dining, QR codes came out years ago, and people tried using them and they failed. You know, Apple didn't even recognize QR. You had to download a second app to do it. So people, it was clunky and people weren't into it. But you know, Asian countries where Androids were used more prevalently were using QR codes all along, and people have been ordering like that for a while. So it just never got adopted in the U.S. But with this happening, people are willing to try things. If I get to go sit at a restaurant, sure, I'll do that. I don't want to touch a menu right now. I'd rather be able to do this and have some sort of an experience. So, you know, we've used that opportunity to sort of try this. And surprisingly, most of our customers don't mind it. They like it. Bartaco is somewhat unique because we had already trained our customers to order on a card and fill out an order together and present that to the server. So they knew how to sort of group order together before this. So that we were kind of primed up to try this. And our customers have accepted it. It's still not frictionless. It's still a little clunky. We're working on it. The technology is not all the way there yet. And, you know, it's our job right now to really dig in and figure out how to make this more seamless, because I'm really interested in, as we come out of COVID, how can we leverage this? How can this be part of our model in a way that we can be more efficient, that we can, you know, we can have a more efficient labor model that, you know, will carry us into the future? Because we all know in our industry, the pressures for full service restaurants is getting, you know, unbearable with the labor models. So, you know, there's a real opportunity to really get some insight here and also train our customers to sort of accept the new normal.
Right. And from a staff point of view, I know that's been, I'd be curious to hear what's their feedback been of all the tech and changes to the workflows and everything.
It's been a mixed bag for the most part. It's been good. But you know, people don't like change. And you know, it's been, there's been people who've pushed back. But at the same time, you know, as it's been going, we've gotten pretty steady with it. And as we get better at it, we're seeing great reviews. Our customers are enjoying the experience. Our staff has found that this is a very predictable, stable model. They're getting paid a very predictable wage. And you know, in these times that are so unpredictable, you know, it's nice that we've found a stable way to run our restaurants and a stable way to pay our staff, and in a way that we're able to not lose a ton of money.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Matt, thinking like kind of where we go from here, I know there's a lot of discussion around what, you know, what happens this winter and what happens post-COVID. So thinking forward a little bit, let's assume, you know, now we have a vaccine and it's broadly distributed and the economy is starting to shake off the COVID hangover. Best case scenario is you're able to keep the off-prem thing dialed in and moving forward, and you're able to get the dining room back to full capacity, and then, you know, that could be the best case scenario. So how are you thinking about what First Watch needs to do to maximize the chance that actually is what happens, is that you keep off-prem and on-prem? And, you know, and how are you thinking about that?
Yeah, sure. Before I do that, I just have to say, Scott, that is wicked cool. Doing that for dine-in is, I'm jealous, is a really good idea, and it's a really cool feature. So, you know, I think it's an interesting question about the balance. You know, I kind of touched on that at the beginning of, you know, the dining room and off-premise. And I'll go on a limb and say this. I think there's a lot of brands out there that are cutting themselves off the knee because you're starting to define the whole experience on convenience. And don't get me wrong, I'm not being preachy. I get it. Like, we're all just trying to survive, 100% understand. But there's something to be said about when you're looking at that balance on the other side of this, whatever the other side looks like. You have to, at some point, you're going to go back to something, right? Whatever it is. And so you have to make sure that you're balancing that experience side. I don't know about you all, but, you know, my wife and I will go out and we'll choose, you know, a place that we really like, and we'll go out and, you know, you've always had good memories of the experiences we've had in these places, obviously. And you walk in and it feels like a naughty place. Like, it feels like a place you shouldn't be. Like, you know, you see big stop signs and sanitized, you know, tables and things like that. And look, we all are trying to keep it safe, but I also think there's something to be said for making sure that you're making that experience in the dining room as warm as possible, because the people that are choosing to come into your dining rooms are choosing to come there for some type of experience. So for us, speaking for what we've done, we've talked a lot about the digital side and the off-premise side, but in the dining room side, you're reading that everyone is slimming down menus, and we have actually invested in making sure we're keeping our full menu, and it's a big menu. But we believe it's important. You think of breakfast. Breakfast is a ritual. You want to come in. You want your familiar favorites. You want that routine. So we've actually made a very conscious effort in investing in that. You know, I'm a little different than Scott, and, you know, we have different businesses. But, you know, we've had a lot of pressure to go to full QR code menus, and I've resisted it. And I'm, you know, paying an exorbitant amount of money in single use menus, but for breakfast, again, I want you to have a menu in your hand. I want you to hold that. And the last thing we've done, you know, in terms of that experience, is we've actually doubled our efforts into adding alcohol to our restaurants. So, you know, hopefully by the end of this year, we'll be in close to half of our corporate restaurants. You'll be able to get brunch cocktails, which, you know, plays on that whole brunch occasion. So, you know, it's really important that you invest in both. And again, then it comes down to, now we have tools in place that we can use, marketing automation, email, push notifications, all types of different ways that we can talk to you in the way that you want to experience First Watch. So it's either about convenience or it's either about experience. And I'm simplifying a bit. But anyway, I guess the message I would say is, it's, you really got to make sure you're keeping balance so that you keep your business defined on both dimensions.
Yeah, right, which underscores the point about collecting customer data and understanding which guests are using you for the off-prem use case, which ones are using you for on-prem. Yeah. And as you start to ramp back into, you know, trying to get on-prem back to where it was pre-pandemic, being able to use that data and get back in front of it. Thanks for that, guys. Next up, let's switch and kind of chat through ops and marketing changes, the more kind of brass tacks stuff. Scott, I know you guys, you have very, very busy restaurants as it is. And when you think about, and, you know, before COVID, off-prem was a pretty small percentage of sales. And I know one of the things you guys have talked about is the kitchen is often a bottleneck, especially when you got a busy restaurant, and you don't want, your philosophy, correct me if I'm wrong, is you don't want to undermine the dine-in guest experience because you got long cook times because your kitchen's crushed trying to handle more volume. So how are you thinking about that? And yeah, I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, we're having to think creatively. The reality is with some of our restaurants doing 30, 40% takeout and doing large numbers, we're seeing the kitchens getting completely destroyed at certain hours, you know, during prime time. We've had to throttle the orders. And the reality is we've had to turn away quite a lot of takeout business. And I would guess as high as 50% of the takeout business in some of our restaurants. Because we do have to prioritize the guest who's there, of course, and prioritize their experience. So that's frustrating, especially in COVID world when your sales are down, that you're actually leaving sales on the table each week. So, you know, it's been driving us a little mad. We are aggressively looking into all sorts of options, both from ghost kitchens to pod kitchens to trailer kitchens to renting closed kitchens of restaurants in areas where we're looking at. We're looking at it all right now. It's a big part of my week every week is doing this because I truly believe that if we can open a kitchen in some of our markets where we're more established and just turn on delivery, really third-party delivery, that you know, the demand's already there. So we really would like to meet that demand. We know it's there. We know there's money to be made. We just have to figure out the logistics.
Yeah, very interesting, especially when you think about all the stuff that Brinker's been talking about with the virtual brands that they've been spinning up. I think that's, you know, the wave of the future.
Yeah, I mean, what's unique is we have an established brand. People want it already. The demand's there. We don't have to build the demand. We just have to build the infrastructure.
Yeah. Yeah, interesting. Have you thought at all about how that could play into your playbook for picking restaurant sites? Like, you could rent a kitchen for a while and test the ordering and see what demand you get.
It's kind of mind-boggling. If this works, but it's all theoretical at this point, if this works, it opens a whole lot of opportunities in markets where we're established, even markets that are just outside of where we're established. We know, like, before we got to Boston, a lot of people in Boston already knew us and wanted our food just because of our, you know, because we're strong in New England. So, yeah, I mean, it opens a whole new world. It's definitely interesting. And, you know, as we go into winter and we start to lose capacity outside, we need to find alternate revenue sources.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Matt, last question, then we'll transition to Q&A. I want to make sure we save some time for that. But been, as long as I've known you, aggressively implementing digital, and it's not, you know, it's not just the systems, and obviously you use Wisely for waitlist and CRM and marketing automation. You have a great agency in Vert, and I know you've been building your own digital team. So what has been your lessons learned as you've gone through that? If you could go back in time and you know one thing that you know now that you didn't know then, like what are some of the lessons you've learned going through that?
Yeah, it's actually a good point, Mike. I'm definitely hiring on the digital side. So if anybody's out there wants to help with those efforts, send me resumes. I'll give it a shameless plug. I'll take this opportunity to say one thing about just the industry and marketing and technology. And you know, I think what the industry is doing to marketing leaders right now is a bit of a travesty. I think marketing leaders today are expected to be magicians and expected to turn things, you know, around and create instant results in a very saturated, well, what was previously a very saturated industry. And so, you know, the reason I bring that up is because it promotes short-term thinking. And I think we're all aware of kind of this merging of kind of marketing and brand and technology and analytics. And I think the more, the next wave of great leaders, I think you're going to see more come out of the marketing side of businesses because of that kind of infusion. But I'd add a third dimension to that, and I think it's going to be even more pronounced from COVID, and then that's operations. You know, think of off-premise, especially like Scott's got 30% of his business and he's turning away 50% of it. You know, for someone to come in, you know, off-premise, for instance, doesn't live in the marketing world. it's as much operations and execution as anything else. We can put a feature out there and allow you to order delivery through an app, say, but if you're not able to work that muscle through the kitchen and make sure and execute it and understand and measure and evaluate and make changes and tweaks, I mean, even where things print on our chits is incredibly important. And we've found ways to prioritize them and put spaces here and there that allow us to forget certain items or stop forgetting certain items. So my point is that, you know, one of the things that can't be overstated to anyone out there in this space is that you really have to have a deep acumen and partnership and understanding of operations. And if you don't just be the person who puts technology in place, take technology and then on your roadmap, have time to see it through, have time to measure it, get feedback, tweak it, make it better before you go on to the next feature. So I'd say that's probably the biggest thing I would say that shows a level of success in this space.
Yeah, that's key. And I think I've seen your mobile app evolve over the time we've worked together too. And I think another key point is it's not just like you're never done improving the restaurants, you're never done improving your tech stack. There's always something more you can be doing to better know the customer. Scott, you might remember one of the conversations that you and I had is you said there's no such thing as knowing your customer too well. It's impossible to do. So, you know, always continuing to figure out what makes the customer tick and what makes them come back. I think you guys are two of the best at that. So I think with that, Alan, we'll kick it back over to you and help us handle some of the questions that have come in.
Thank you for a great conversation and presentation, gentlemen. Questions have come in, so let's get to them. I will remind the audience members that they can still enter questions into the Q&A windows on their console, and we'll address as many as we can in the time we have remaining. But let's ask the first question that I've got here, and that is, for Matt and Scott, what are your biggest concerns during the pandemic? What scenarios are they planning for? Scott, why don't you start that?
Well, obviously the biggest concern is, you know, that we have a resurgence here in the fall, you know, coupled with the flu and kids going back to school and all the things that are happening. You know, if we go back to a lockdown, you know, that could be pretty catastrophic. So the other concern is just weather. As you know, we've all expanded our restaurants out into parking lots and patios and wherever we can put tables and chairs. So I'm sure we're all doing the same dance right now of figuring out what happens when it gets cold, what happens when the weather turns. You know, I mean, I'm not lucky to have all my restaurants in Florida or in that area, you know, where a lot of them are in the Northeast. So, you know, our patio season is already getting cooler here. So, you know, we have to think about what's going to happen, you know, as we lose capacity, because especially if we are, you know, if we're not gaining capacity in our dining rooms because the virus. So, you know, that's going to be a challenge. And I touched on it before when we were talking about the ghost kitchens, is we're trying to think of a couple things. How do we keep the outside areas? How do we create capacity in weather? We're also thinking about how do we find alternate revenue sources? Because, you know, it's going to be a long winter, as they say.
All right. Matt, you have a thought on that?
I don't know if I'd add much different than Scott. I mean, it's for us, it's about our people. You know, we have restaurants. Some of our biggest markets are Orlando, Phoenix, you know, in Texas. And it can't be understated, you know, what these teams deal with every day. We have just incredible culture and incredible people. But, you know, it all goes to say that, you know, it's a people business. And so the weather worries us, too. And it's something you just monitor every single day. I mean, on the other side, the other thing that worries me is the kitchens do remain, the dining rooms do move back, and off premise stays where it is. And, you know, we're our peaks are our peaks. I mean, you think Saturdays and Sundays, it's busy days in our restaurants. So, you know, we've really got a challenge ahead of us in balancing that as well.
One of the things I would shamelessly plug in there, just to throw it in there, is as restaurants kind of have, they can't really be outside as much. It's, what it means is every table, if you're at 50% capacity, every table is worth two times what it was before, right? So optimizing those, figuring out you have the right mix of tables, the right number of twos, fours, having those configured properly, that's a data question, right? And so some of the things we're doing for our clients is able to actually tell them what their demand looks like. And, you know, Scott, I know when we've been running your waitlist for a while, we've got tons of data of how that looks, you know, seasonally and even in real time. So you guys could make adjustments week to week. I think that's going to be optimizing and continuing to look at what demand looks like is going to be key heading into the winter.
No question.
Okay. Good thought. Here's a question for Matt. It said, you said waitlist was a top tech feature for customers. I imagine it's mostly used on the weekend. Is that true? And do guests use it even when the wait is not anticipated? So what kind of participation do you have in your wait list?
Yeah, you know, I will give a shameless plug to Wisely here, because one of the biggest things that our previous app was a two-star app, and the biggest complaint was that what would happen is you'd go to add yourself to the wait list, and it would say, hey, we have no wait. Come on in. You get in your car, you drive to the restaurant, and all of a sudden there's a 20, 25, 30-minute wait. And you know, you think about it, it's pretty frustrating. So the answer is yes, by all accounts, Saturdays and Sundays are the biggest use of that. But one of the things we now allow our customers to do, which is amazing for COVID, is you can put your name on the wait list at any time. And even if there's not a wait, it holds that and has that communicated to our restaurants, which is important for, you know, data capture. But then also, if you think of like telling them that they have to bring a mask and all that communication that you can have and set expectations ahead, that touch point has been incredibly important by having that feature enabled.
Okay, here's another question for the operators. It says, what does your board say about digital? How do they want you to justify those investments? So Scott, you want to start with that one?
Sure. Catterton has been incredibly supportive. In fact, they've jumped in, rolled their sleeves up, and helped me out. Their analysts have dove in. They're vetting technology. They see both the need and the opportunity that's presented right now. And you know, they're very much behind it. They see it as the future.
So Matt, you've touched on that a little bit.
I'm sorry,
Scott, you've touched on that a little bit, but what else can you say?
You know, their analysts have provided reports for us comparing, you know, the different technologies and giving us the pluses and the minuses. They have been just lockstep with us, you know, weekly calls, talking about progress, measurement. It hasn't been a question of closing the purse. You know, it's been a question of investing wisely so that we can use this money to really both take care of our customers and our staff right now, but also what does the future look like and how can this be helpful going forward? You know, they've been very much a part of that conversation.
Okay, Matt, sorry I interrupted you. Why don't you tell us a little bit about this digital question and your board support?
Yeah, definitely no justification needed. But again, we had already had a roadmap aligned, and so we actually invested into COVID. I mean, even though we had been shutting down restaurants for a period of time, we had a large cash outlay and investment because we already understood the importance of what our growth was going to come through, and a vast majority of it was going to come through digital and off-premise. So, you know, we've been here for 37 years, and we viewed it as simply a way to do what we do better, not to change what we do. So, yeah, incredibly, incredibly supportive.
One thing to chime in, Alan, if I may.
Absolutely.
I think a lot of times pre-COVID, the topic of CRM and knowing your customer, that was something that people have been talking about for a long time. And it got really, really practical once COVID hit, because you had to tell everyone, here's how to get, you know, here's how to order online. Here's how everything we're doing to keep the guests safe. So it was a lifeline to communicate with the customer. And we saw all the messages our clients were sending go up 500% almost overnight since COVID hit. So there's like way more messaging being sent to guests to communicate. So I think that's a key part of it, is brands, guests do want to hear from the brands that are their favorites.
Okay, here's a question that asks, you've touched on loyalty, Matt, having worked at Piata and First Watch. What is your opinion about the loyalty programs that we've seen to date? So tell us about loyalty programs and what we're seeing so far.
That's a loaded question for me. You know, I, I'll be very honest. I'm not a believer of out-of-the-box loyalty. I think unless you're a daily needs brand like, you know, Dunkin' and Starbucks and maybe even, you know, Chipotle, that, you know, you're not going to build more loyal customers because you have a discount, an unexpected discount. So I don't believe in it. I think you build loyalty through customization and accessibility. You know, using Chipotle as an example, yeah, they have a rewards program, and I'm sure they'll align their results with that. But look, I go to Chipotle because it's a fantastic app with smooth experience, saving, making it quick, and I can have it delivered, you know. So I think it's really important that, you know, you not turn to a shortcut in an out-of-the-box loyalty program. Take the long road, build the program, build customization, and know your customers.
Scott, any add-ons to that?
No, actually, Matt said exactly what I think. I'm completely on the same page with him, to be honest with you. Loyalty's never been as a program, sort of as you get points or you get a free taco after every fourth. That's not ever been our approach. You know, we build loyalty by getting to know our customers and making them feel at home and making our restaurant an extension of their living room, a place that they want to be. That's how we build loyalty. It's much more organic. It's not as much of like a point system where you get to be a gold, platinum, whatever.
Okay. So, folks, we're at our limit, but I'm going to ask one or two other questions quickly. This is the lightning round. You already had a lightning round. Lightning round two. So here's a question that asks, what's an example of customer data you uncovered and how did you action it to improve your business? Either one of you, gentlemen, what's one example of something you uncovered in the data that you've used to build a business?
I'll jump on one that just came out this morning. We have someone who is digging in now to online orders, and again, it's only 3 months old, but has uncovered the vast disparity and differences between weekday morning orders and lunch orders and types of orders on the weekend. And you can see how a weekend occasion is different than an early Tuesday morning. And so, you know, really that is being used to think about how do we look at that behavior on early weekday mornings and customize menu and communication to accommodate to a different need state.
Yeah, I mean, we turn stuff up every day. I mean, today we figured out that the quote time that we're giving for our takeout versus the time that people are actually getting there, there's a big disparity, and people are coming and getting cold food sometimes. So, you know, we found certain restaurants are worse than others about doing it, but through the social listening and seeing, you know, all the comments come up, and also through our secret shoppers and a few others, we saw it in a few different places, and it raised the red flag.
Okay, this is the last question, and I've got to make it quick because I'm taking us too long. But Matt, we'll start with you, 30 words or less. It says, what are you doing to keep the connection with your guests that are ordering online and not coming to the restaurants anymore?
So they're not coming, so they're only coming through off-premise?
Yeah, they've moved to off-premise, and, you know, what are you doing to sort of keep that experiential connection, or what are you doing to keep the connection with your brand?
Yeah, for us, it's easy because we didn't have an app environment previously. So, and I think about, you know, you think of each stage of the guest journey, you know that people want to first start ordering through your website, which is where the vast majority of our orders have originated. And then what happens is people get comfortable ordering from you. You know, an app type experience is something that allows them to do what they want to do faster. And so for us, you know, it's like a pig in a python. You're trying to pass people down a certain journey. That we're focused on making sure that people understand that you don't have to come to a website to do this. We'll put the app in your hand and we'll let you save your orders and create an account and allow you to do that with a few clicks of a button on your favorite order. So, you know, our focus is on migrating them from desktop to phone.
All right, Scott, your thoughts on how you can maintain that connection?
Yeah, you know, Instagram is a big. We have a huge following on Instagram, and we constantly have influencers who are coming up and posting, and that we've challenged them to show how they bartaco at home. So we see people setting up picnics and setting up, getting their best margarita glasses, and having a taco party at home. We've also put together a bunch of playlists on Spotify because we have great music in our restaurants, so people are able to actually get the vibe, play the music, bring home a margarita kit, bring home a taco kit and have a party, and they're posting it. So it's all over social media.
Good idea. Some good ideas. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's all the time we have for now. I'd like to thank our speakers, Mike Vichich of Wisely, Scott Lawton of Bartaco, and Matt Eisenbach, Matt Eisenacker of First Watch.
I thought you were going to mess Mike up.
I know. Yeah. Matt, we want to thank them for sharing their insights. Thank them for sharing their insights. We want to thank Wisely for their sponsorship and support of this program. That wraps up this session, but Restaurants Rise will be back at 3:15 Eastern with our next section, How to Make Curbside Appealing. You can click on the link in your console to register for that session directly and visit restaurantsrise.com for more details. Thanks again for joining us and for your questions. And please take advantage of our remaining sessions. Have a very good day.